guys are so quiet. What's going on? It's causing me stress here. You guys are so quiet, you know. When the kids got quiet, when they were younger and the kids got quiet in the house, you knew something was wrong, right? So quit being quiet, okay? Hello, church. Good to have worship with you today. We're going to have us a good time as we worship together and celebrate Jesus. I just want you to know that it is good to see you, and I thank you for being here today. We've got some things to talk about. Now, there are some things in the bulletin that you're going to need to read for yourself, just so you're aware. I'm not going to mention everything there, but I do want you to know that there's stuff in there that you need to be aware of. Roger's got an announcement to begin with. So, Rog, there, look pretty.
Am I standing up?
Yeah.
I'm a member of the mission board at the church here, and we want to get some people involved in going to the Church of the Nazarene up off Richfield Road in Otisville. What it is Feed My Starving Children. It's a Christian nonprofit striving to eliminate starvation of children around the world. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. There's 3 days you can sign up for, and there's two-hour blocks. You can do one block, or you can do several blocks. It all depends on you, but there's a sign-up sheet in the back. We encourage everybody to do it. The dates are October the 12th from 6 to 8 p.m., October 13th from 9 to 11, and 11:45 to 1:45, and October 14th, 9 to 11 a.m. and 12 to 2 p.m. We'd appreciate some help. I plan on being there myself, so help us out.
So Roger, what is a manna pack? What's in a manna pack?
I'm not sure. We're just, okay. What your job will be, like an assembly line, you'll have a certain thing to put in a box and be passed on down the line. It's just to help get the boxes packed faster and that way. So.
Good. All righty. So manna, if you ever want to know what manna looks like, come on over and manna pack. Okay, good. So I'm assuming it's a box and you're filling it up as you go down the line. There you go. That's great. Hey, a couple things for you. We've got small groups that have already started. We've been in 1 week now, but it's not too late for you to be a part of that small group. Remember, small groups are about building relationships together. And that's what our purpose is. We're coming together. We're studying God's word. But our main purpose is to have relationships, building relationships together. You might be here as a person, a new person who's trying to get maybe acclimated or, you know, into a new place. This is a great opportunity for you. Small groups are non-threatening. And it's a great opportunity. So if you're new here, you might want to consider this. I would encourage you to do it, and you'll be happy you did. All righty, the small groups are going really well so far in our congregation. We've got 59 people involved with that. 59 people, and you might be number 60. Okay, so sign up back there if you would on the sign up sheet at the Welcome Center for small groups. Next week, we're having a special speaker, and that is Brian Johnson. He is the executive minister of the state of Michigan for our denomination. And you might say, wow, that sounds exciting. Let me tell you, you will not want to miss Brian's message next week. You won't want to miss it, okay? Now, I try as best I can to advertise things that I know are really good, okay? And so I am advertising this to you, and I'm telling you in advance, you will be blessed through his message. Brian is an excellent speaker, and he really is in tune with where God is, what God would want for us, and I think that you'll really be blessed by hearing his message next week. So just so you know, I am advertising for him because he's an excellent speaker, and he really will help you to come closer to Jesus. So, next week, Sunday, We're going to be here. Brian will be speaking, and I'll be celebrating along with him. I'll be cheering for him. Alrighty? Well, it's good to be in worship today. All I can say is relax, sing out loud, praise God with your heart and your mind, and fill this building with praise. All right? Let's go. Let's do it.
On that and fill this room and just shake the roof?
We can do it.
Are you ready to shake the roof off this place? Yeah. All right, let's stand and sing.
God, we come before you today and acknowledge you as our God. We are here to worship you and to celebrate you and to thank you for all that you've done, Lord. You are a good God, and we are a thankful people. Lord God, it is obvious that this world has trust issues. Trust issues are all around us. And Lord, we sometimes can have those same trust issues, but you have trained us, you have shown us, you have proven to us that we can trust you. You have kept your word, you have kept your word all the way through, and we give you praise today for doing exactly what you said you would do. And Lord, we know that there are promises still to be fulfilled, and we take you at your word, knowing that you have done in the past great things, and you will take care of the things you promised in the future as well. Lord, thank you for that trust issue that has been resolved. Thank you, Lord, for doing many things for us that we give you thanks today for. It is great to be in this place with others who have experienced you as the great and good God. We thank you, we honor you, we celebrate you, we lift the name of Jesus up, and we thank you, Lord, for providing all this, even though we do not deserve it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to mention to you that communion will be following the anthem. If you would, just prepare yourself, prepare your hearts for that communion. Thank you. I can't tell you how many times I've done communion. As you might expect, once a month for a few years of ministry, and you've done communion many times. But there is one thing that I think is important. There's some things in the Bible that I look at and I say, you know, I don't understand that. In a moment, I want to talk to you about that. Gentlemen, come on down. As you take the elements today, as you take the cup, as you take the bread, remember again what the Lord has done for you. The scripture says, when the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus said, I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. It's that part that I have been very eager. I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you. I don't know about you, but knowing the sequence of events and knowing that Jesus knew the sequence of events as well, we look at it from the past, looking back, and or looking from this side, looking back, and so we know what's going to happen. Well, Jesus was aware as well what was going to happen. And still he says, I have been very eager. They were together 24/7 for 3 years. I mean, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 3 years. Yet, for this moment, he is eager. Not just eager, but very eager. eager, anxious, excited, enthused. In athletic terms, it might be pumped. This would be the fulfillment of the Passover, the final perfect sacrifice. They had been physically together all this time, but this communion would bring them spiritually together as one. Physically, now spiritually. This morning, we celebrate our oneness. All made possible by Jesus our Savior. The scripture says he provided his body in death so that we could have life, so that it could be life for us. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Remember, Jesus is eager, very eager, to give this to you. Eat with that in mind. He gave his life's blood in death, so that it could be forgiveness for us. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people." The new covenant, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. The new covenant given. He was very eager to have this relationship begin. The new covenant, the blood of Jesus. Lord God, we celebrate you today because without you having done this for us, we would still be left in our sin, unforgiven, with no hope, no chance for salvation, hell for eternity. But because of what you did for us, you have provided life. You have provided forgiveness. And for this, we are truly grateful. Help us to live a life that proves that we really are thankful for what you've done. Help us to live a life that is different, that is on fire, that is filled with praise. Help us to be as eager to do that for you than you were eager to do this for us. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand as we sing?
There's a place where screams are Yeah.
Thank you, Praise Band. Appreciate that. That's excellent. Great. I want to thank all of you who came to the prayer day yesterday. As we came together to pray, you know, what it does is it spiritually connects us. And something about prayer, when we pray together, there's something that happens. And I can't necessarily tell you what that is. I just know that there's something that happens when God's people connect, pray as one. There's something about that that is powerful. It allows us to refocus our efforts and make sure that we're together. Causes us to rethink God's purpose. Through prayer, we are able to become one unlike any other way. And so I just want you to know how happy I am that you, those of you who were able to come to the prayer day, I want to thank you for doing that. I know that it's one of those painful things to get up early on Saturday morning and come down here at 9 o'clock and to be here till 12. We had a good time as we tried to determine where we've been, where we are, and where we need to be. And that's what we did. So thank you for being a part of that. Last week, we started one of those things that is enduring. It is the practice after worship. You know, we go through worship here, and then you may not know, but the choir, I guess it's the special choir. It's not the Sunday morning choir. It's the special choir, and you know that word special has meaning here. It's the special choir that will be doing the musical that's happening at the end of the year at the anniversary celebration of our church, 165 years. But what happens is we need to practice sometime, and so that practice happens after worship service. We take a break for lunch, and then we come back in here. So while you're doing your thing, whatever, and we're down here slaving. No, I'm just joking. It's fun. It's fun to sing together. And oh, let me do this for you. Let me do this for you. Here we go. Here we go. Here. Whoopee! Okay, is that good? Whoopee! Yeah. I don't, you come on down. We're gonna have a good time. And what was that? Yeah, it's good. It's good. I like it. I like it. I like it. I like it. I like it a lot. Okay, let's go ahead. Anyway, what happened last Sunday is this. We went to worship. We practiced. And then what we have to do is, by that time, I am starving. Okay? Or I think I am, at least. You can see on my body that I've got a lot to starve, don't you think? You know what I mean? If you're burning fat when you're starving, I can go for a ways, all right? Just so you know, I'm admitting that. But we went out to Chinese food, okay? Now, I love Chinese food. I really do. I just think that there's something about that's a turn-on for me. So I like Chinese food. Having shown up with no restraint, after that meal, I got up from the table and realized that I had sinned greatly. And the sin was gluttony. I'm here to say it was gluttony, you know. And I don't know. Sometimes I guess I do this and don't realize that I'm doing it. But unknowingly, it was one of those I can't believe I ate the whole thing, you know. And I'm rubbing my pregnant belly, you know. I got up from the table and I guess I was doing this, you know. And I heard a voice from another table saying, "Well, did you get enough to eat?" And I guess I was doing this because I caught myself at that very moment doing this and saying, "Well, yeah, I did. I did. I am full. I am full." And then I was continuing to talk to this guy, and I said, I'm a pastor of a church, so I guess you could call me a, a full gospel preacher, you know? Yeah, yeah. And he said, well, I'm a pastor too. And I said, well, excellent. As if I couldn't tell that. I mean, he looked like a pastor. He had all the pastoral stuff, you know what I mean? People don't accuse me of being a pastor very often because I don't think I look like one most of the time. Thank you for that confirmation. But I don't think I want to look like a pastor either. I don't know, but he looked like a pastor. He had the pastoral look, if you know what I mean. And he said, well, I'm a pastor too. And then he got to telling me about, yeah, he's been a pastor. He's 77 years old and he's been a pastor. He's been in the Flint area in the same church since 1989. And he never told me his name, and I forgot to ask. So I can't call him by name this morning. But he just said, people call me the bishop. Not because I'm a bishop, but because I've been in pastoral ministry in the same place forever. And he was telling me about the stuff that he's been doing over the years, and we got to talking, having a great time. You see, there was an instant connection between us. You see, this is what you need to understand. We were brothers from a different mother. It was obvious. God had brought us together. Last Sunday, we were brought together for that divine meeting. The truth emerged. Although we have different mothers, we have the same Father in heaven. We've walked down the same road to find salvation through Jesus Christ. Our faith in Jesus made us one. In Jesus, it made us one. I call him a brother because that's who he is. The blood of Jesus runs through our veins. And the blood of Jesus has taken away our sins. I found out that my brother started out as a Muslim. He says, I was a Muslim. But then he was introduced to Jesus. And through that, he recognized the difference between an angry God and a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. As I walked away, it was as if God said, Mike, there's your next sermon. You're supposed to talk about that at your next sermon. Just like our biological family, we haven't chosen these spiritual brothers and sisters for ourselves. They've been chosen for us. The scripture says in Romans 8, verse 29, for God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. We are tied together as the family because we belong to Jesus Christ. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 46. Listen to this. As Jesus, oh, by the way, he's been saying some things and all, and I don't know how this works, but his family, Jesus' family, thought he was going crazy, so they were coming to collect him. And Jesus doesn't help out the matter with what he says here. Listen to this. As Jesus was speaking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside, asking to speak to him. Someone told Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside, and they want to speak to you. Jesus asked, who is my mother? Who are my brothers? Then he pointed to his disciples and said, look, These are my mother and brothers. Anyone who does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. What happens when we meet with a fellow Christian? There's a belief connection. What did I know about this man, this pastor, simply by hearing that he's a Christian? What did he know about me? We are brought together, connected together, because our connection with Jesus, you see. We are both followers of Jesus. And as followers of Jesus, it means that I know my brother. You do understand this, right? You can be psychic in this way. You know your brother. I knew him. I know the direction of his life. He's a follower of Jesus just as I am. Because of that, I understand the priorities of his life. I know what moves him and the principles he's trying to live by. I know that he's trying to please God with his life just as I am. I know that God comes first in his life because that's what followers are all about. I know that he's trying to be the best example that he can be so that when others look at him and the way that he lives his life, they are brought to Jesus too. We stand together as brothers because we've come to Jesus. The same way. Saved by the same blood of Jesus. Saved by grace, not by works. We are brothers not because I say so. We are brothers because Jesus says so. Here's a guy I've never met. Someone I've never seen before. Just for clarity, he's a black man from Flint, and I'm a white guy from Davison. But that different skin tone, that different location, makes no difference in this family. The world always wants to maximize the differences. It's always about division, isn't it? How many times do you hear about race this and race that and racist? And oh man, I think our dogs are racist. Like certain people better than others. This world, you see, wants to emphasize race, the color of our skin, all for the purpose of separation and tearing people apart, dividing us by our looks or ethnic differences. But when I met my brother from a different mother, for the first time in that restaurant, our similarities became the emphasis. We instantly had something to talk about, something to celebrate, something in common to bond us together. He's my brother in Christ. That race stuff that the world constantly harps on has no place in this discussion. When we meet people who are believers, it should be like a family reunion, because that's what it is. But one problem with all this is that some Christian believers have a warped idea about what the family is and what brothers and sisters are to be like. They've been bathed or grown up in one of those messed up, dysfunctional families out there. And you might be one of those that's been raised in one of those dysfunctional homes. Your family gatherings or reunions might have included lots of spirits, loud arguments, fist fights, police, arrests. The video they took of that event had the theme song of the show Cops playing in the background. You know, bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Yeah, that one. It wasn't if something wild and weird was gonna happen. The only question was when. Dysfunctional brothers and sisters. It's almost as if they've modeled their relationships after Cain and Abel or Jacob and Esau. Some have no clue what brothers and sisters are to act like. They got used to the fights and sibling rivalries, and they just continue that. Jealousy, tension, and anger were the norm in the family 24/7. Dysfunction. This family concept that we are to practice in the church was taught to us by Jesus, passed down to us by Peter and Paul. The church family concept was emphasized as the body of Christ in the New Testament. We are to care for one another as a loving family. We are to look after each other as those who care and those who are family. When Paul had the chance to divide the new Gentile believers with from the old Jewish believers, he went out of his way to bring them together. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19, it sounded like this. Listen. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with all of God's holy people. Listen, you are members of God's family. In Romans, Paul reminds the family, don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. There should be nothing that is more connected, nothing that is more committed than family. When it comes to this congregation, every one of us ought to be committed to our church family. When we meet each other, there ought to be instant joy. If we really are the church family, really are brothers and sisters, there should be an inner excitement when we meet Sunday in this building. When we see each other in the store during the week, spontaneous joy should happen when we see each other. There should be instant excitement when you meet a church brother or sister, unless you find yourself sort of out of bounds in that moment. You see, out of bounds in that moment was where Reba found herself. I was sick. I was on my deathbed. I don't get sick very often, but when I get sick, I do it well. And I was sicker than, as they say, a dog. That's really sick. I had congestion and the cough, and I was achy all over. You know? know what I'm talking about? It's just that, oh man, I was out of it. It was time. She called my mother for the recipe. You know the recipe? You see, my mom and dad had all kinds of family remedies. It's amazing how those home remedies seem to work. I don't know why, but they all seem to work. Weirdest stuff. But only my mom would know the recipe. You see, that was her side of the family. Lemon juice, water, honey, and some kind of alcohol. She called it a hot toddy. I don't really know what a toddy is, but it was hot. Being non-drinkers, it was the last item on the list that we didn't have in our house. I was in no shape to get it. So Reba went shopping. Have you ever had to buy something at the store that you felt like you needed to buy some other things just to sort of cover it up? You've been there, huh? Yes. So that's what she did. Going down the aisle, she selected some things, and when she had enough, she selected the item off the booze shelf. Now, I'm glad it was Reba that went, because I have no clue as to what kind of alcohol was used here, but it was effective. She selected the appropriate kind because she had talked to my mom, who had the recipe. And she stuck in her cart. Swiftly going down the aisle, she thought maybe she'd pick up some other stuff to cover up the small bottle of alcohol. Turning the corner, she's face to face with the church lady of our church. When I say church lady, does that bring to mind anything? Church lady. Mm-hmm. Nice person, eagle eyes, see through walls. And even had the source before the internet to be the internet. She turns the corner face to face with the church lady. Reba has instant guilt. She was not happy to see the church lady. There's one of those, get me out of here. Instantly, I'm certain that she thought that the lady had seen what was in her cart. But I bet, since I wasn't there, I would just imagine that Reba's guilt complex told the story. She probably said, "Don't look at my cart," in her face. "Don't look in my cart. I'm on the verge of doing something wrong here." Anyway, meeting the church lady, you see, there was no joy here. It wasn't excitement here. It wasn't a family reunion. It was a, I got to get out of here as fast as I can and get away from you. There are times. When it's not a celebration to meet your church people, that was one of them. She did get out. I don't think the church lady ever knew, because it wasn't spread around. I got better. I think we still have some of that alcohol at the It's back there, and it's dust covered. It's never been touched again. Anybody who needs that, let me know. It's aged. I mean, it's aged a while. But did we throw it away? We should have lit a fire with it or something. That was fire water. Yeah. What I'm saying is this. There are times when you don't really like to see the church folk. And when that happens, you need to question why. Because the actual thing that should happen is there should be a celebration when we see each other. How you doing? It's good to see you. You know, I love you. And I'd give you a kiss right now if you weren't a man, you know? When we come into this place, the first thing that you ought to recognize is you're with family. And when others come into this place, the first thing they should recognize is this. They ought to recognize that the family loves each other. It just should be an obvious. And when somebody says, wow, you're a real friendly bunch, I should say, well, yeah, that's the way it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be that way. We're family. We love each other. But over time, is it possible that we've forgotten who we are? We've gotten away from maybe that church family idea in our expressions. Over time, we may have concluded that it's a little corny or old-fashioned to use the official titles, you know, our official titles. But it would do us well to once again refer to each other out of the truth of who Jesus said we are. Brother Dan. Look at that. Brother Dan. Brother Mike. Oh, Sister Linda. Brother Bill. Sister Candy. You remember when that used to be? You remember in the old time church when people would call each other brother and sister? We've gotten away from that, haven't we? We really have. And I think by getting away from that, we may have forgotten a little bit that this is the roots of who we are. That's the roots of where we need to be. We need to hear more, yo, bro. Yo, sis. Because that's who we are. Were that because Jesus said we are? He's given us the title. Maybe we should begin to use it more. And by doing that, be reminded often that, yeah, we really are a church family. And I don't apologize it one bit. I don't apologize for that at all. You're my brothers. You're my sisters. And I love you. Let's pray. Lord God, I pray that you'll bless my brother that I met last week. I pray, Lord, that you'll bless him in his ministry, that you'll bless him, make him shine, so that people will see that he loves you and he's for you and his life magnifies that. Lord, I thank you for my brother that we have the same Father. And I thank you for my brothers and sisters here today that we can come into this place and enjoy the fellowship with one another, and the celebrate when we get together, and that relationship being renewed brings joy in our lives. Lord, help us to let just to release the emotion when it comes to that and allow ourselves to enjoy the fellowship with one another as you have designed it, Lord. May we be one, and may we be one happy, joyful, loving, kind family. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, I'm glad you came today. I hope that if you haven't figured out that you're a part of a loving family, I hope that that'll be something that you'll begin to see more of, and even think about your place in it. Thank you for being here, brother, sister. They'll accept you, Mike. Take care, folks. Have a great day.